Hi everyone, and thank you, Meltem, for this short introduction. So maybe I should begin by announcing the fact that the publication of this exhibition has been just out. Starting from today, the book we prepared to accompany this exhibition is actually available at the Artar bookstore in English and Turkish. With that, I'm going to share my screen, and as I speak and introduce this conversation, I wanted to share with you some images from the exhibition as a background. Just a minute, where is it? Yes, there it is. So it's just a slideshow that I will put into play in the background as I speak, in which you might see views from the exhibition, stills from the film, just as a reminder for those of you who have seen it and for those of you who haven't seen it, just to have a view in our minds. So I would like to start today by introducing David Marotto, who is our guest. He's an artist and researcher. And then I will explain how Emre Hüner and myself have encountered his research over time in the process of making this exhibition. And to end with the core, some of the core subjects we will be touching upon. And then I will pass it along to David and Emre. So some of you might know, David is an artist, and he's the author of the recently published two-volume book, The Artist's Novel, A New Medium, and The Artist's Novel, The Fantasy of the Novel, published by Moose Publishing. In it, he proposes the concept of the artist's novel as a new medium in visual arts, as distinct from what a literary novel might be, also as distinct from what an artist book might be. So this double book is the result of a practice-led PhD he completed at Edinburgh College of Arts. But it's also the culmination of years-long interest and research into what the artist's novel might be. And the way Emre Hüner and me, we encountered this research was in preparing Elektroizolasyon, the exhibition, at the beginning of our process, in any case, of Emre's process. There was a lot of writing. Emre had been writing short fictions, longer fictions in a number of manuscripts, and he was gathering these forms of narratives. And I think at the beginning of this, before there was even the idea of this exhibition, I think what he had in mind was a novel. I think he was imagining that all of this material that he'd been producing would maybe culminate in a novel. But then the invitation to do an exhibition at Artar came. And that material, that all of this writing that he'd been doing became kind of the starting point for us to think of this exhibition. What he did was that he had distilled these different forms of writings were distilled in a written script. That he shared with me, and that became a tool for us from the start to find a common language and imagine together what the exhibition would be about and what it would look like. But then it also became an essential element for every single person who participated in the making of this. This including a film and sculptures and installations. So it was a collective process, and the script became the central point or the central document that we would all share. But also it was within the process, it was also being constantly rewritten. I mean, in shooting the film and producing the sculptures, which was a long span of time, with the input of other people who were collaborating, Emre was constantly also rewriting the script and adding new sequences, new scenes. So it was a mutually generative process between what you see in the exhibition and this, what I call script. Now, this is the process of it, but today when you enter into this exhibition as an audience member, there are several elements. There's a 5-hour and 20-minute film, which is looped, which plays in a constant loop on a screen. And then there are the sculptural elements, installations, prints, silk screens, and so on. And then there's a collection of short form fiction, a collection of six fictional narrative sort of stories that are gathered in a volume, which is called Hypernauts, under the title Hypernauts by Meliha Eram. Now, this was produced in mass numbers and both in Turkish and English. and it was made available as a takeaway from the exhibition. So as an audience member, when you go into this exhibition, you see, of course, the spatial installations and the sculptures, but there are all these narrative forms that are present, the film being one of them. And then there's this fictional narrative gathered that you can take away at home and read afterwards, or you can also just read. There are, some of them are really short, like one page, some of them are longer, 4 to 5 pages. So this was in a way elevated, at least the intention was to elevate this to this kind of the same status as everything else that was in the exhibition. So when we were working through all of these materials and if within the process of making the exhibition, we were also trying to locate, you know, other forms, similar forms that might have occurred in the past, or find some research to kind of reflect on what the status of all of this writing can be in the form of an exhibition, like in making an exhibition. What is the position of this artist's writing within this exhibition? This was a constant dialogue we had with Emre, and some of the answers that we actually found initially in a book published, published, edited by David Marotto and Joanna Zierinska, which is called The Artist Novel, The Book Lovers Publication. Now, this dates from 2015, and this was a collective book with a number of contributions ranging from Roland Barthes to Henry Darger, Liam Gillick, Kenneth Goldsmith, Tom McCarthy, Seth Siegelob, Guy Quante, and so on. And it gathered various materials they actually published extracts from actual artist novels. There were interviews and there were critical essays discussing this, what an artist novel might be in the context of the visual arts. This was our first encounter, and we both read this book. And then, you know, starting from that publication, we circled back to all the projects that, you know, David himself and sometimes together with Joanna Zierinska has been producing in the last 7 to 8 years. And one of them is, I want to insist on two things, and Maltam will be sharing links with you through chat if you want to take a look at these, any one of these projects. One of them is a tool, I think, which I find very, very important for anyone working or researching in this field, is that they created an online database of every artist's novel that they could find that was produced, that was being produced, or also historical. There are historical works also in it. So this online database is hosted now at the Contemporary Art Museum in Antwerp. And you can access it, and you can also, it's very well indexed. You can also do research on research by author or by artistic strategy. So this is a very interesting research tool for anyone interested, and it's growing. I know for a fact that it's not finished. They're adding new contents as they discover them. And the second one is a project that they co-curated through an open call for an artist's novel to be produced. And it was Tamam Shud by Alex Cecchetti. And the host institution for this was the Jodowski Castle Contemporary Art Center in Warsaw, where they actually, there's the whole process of David acting as a co-curator in a process of writing of an artist's novel, which culminates in the publication of the actual book, Tamam Shud by Alex Cecchetti by Sternberg Press. But there was also an exhibition hosted by this institution. And I'm mentioning this because in the double volume that we will be speaking of today, which constitutes the core of this conversation. So it's a double volume because there are two books. There's a new medium, which is more theoretical, and which includes also 4 case studies with specific artists and a number of interviews. And then there's the fantasy of novel, which itself is a novel written by David, relating all of the process of Tamam Shud in a partially fictionalized manner. So hence the double volume in this context. To date, as far as I know, this work, the artist's novel publication, is the first one to attempt to recognize and conceptualize and historicize the artist's novel as a medium in visual arts. Although artists have been writing novels for a very, very long time, there hasn't been much critical thinking before David's work. And the question being, you know, what does the writing of a novel perform in relation to an art exhibition, but also in relation to producing artworks and distributing artworks, and also in terms of the relationship with the audience, what does it do? And these are some of the topics that we will be covering today, focusing specifically on Electroisolation, Emre Hünar's exhibition at Artar. Just as a short introduction to what I think, there are two ways in which narrative fiction or narrativity operates in this exhibition. The first one is in terms of audience experience, which I spoke of a little bit before, but the presence of Hypernauts, a collection of short stories within the exhibition, as a mass-produced booklet, which share the same status as all the other works in the exhibition. And then the second one, which has more to do with the process of making this exhibition, with the script, the centrality of the script, which is absent, but present by its absence in many ways. Which all of which leads to the central question of the status of such a script within the visual artistic process. With this being said, I want to read a short, very, very short fragment from David's book, The Fantasy of the Novel, which is the novel one. So this is the book where we have a fictionalized rendering of the production process of Alex Cecchetti's novel. But there are one paragraph and one little sentence which will give us a cue and which resonated a lot with our experience with Emre of the production of his exhibition. So here it goes. The art project wasn't meant to trigger real situations that would end up fictionalized in the artist's novel, as Jarek had suggested. The relationship between the making of the artworks and the writing of the artist's novel was subtler than that. They both shared the same narrative, came from the same place. The narrative was articulated by means of the episodic performances and later by the exhibition, and expressed in the artist's novel's text. Not that one would breed the other, rather they were communicating vessels within the same system. The art project was the recipient of a lot of ideas, motives, dialogues, and imagery that spawned by the insertion of new and old works in the Tamamşul universe. And the rewriting undergone by both the host narrative and the guest artworks was trickling down into the manuscript that was being produced. So this is one short excerpt. And then a little earlier in the book, there's a conversation that happens between Joanna and David, and in which we found this sentence. It's something that Joanna says, actually. For him, an artistic idea isn't something to stick to rigidly all the way, but a tentative scenario that takes definitive form in a particular setting. Now, this sentence in particular, I wanted to read because this is where we actually took the title of this conversation from, those three concepts, tentative scenario, definitive form, particular setting, are very close to some of the terms that we were using with Emre when we were trying to understand what it was that we were doing and where this whole process was going. And these are also some of the extracts from the book that Emre shared with me when he was reading it. And then before I ask a few questions, I think I need to clarify a few things, especially in regards to the concept of the artist's novel as a medium. And to do that, I'm going to actually switch the presentation. I won't stop sharing, just a minute, but I have this other PDF. Here it is. So this is an image of, this is the cover of Artist Novel Part 1, A New Medium. And I wanted to share with you the definition that David came up with in this book, specifying what an artist's novel is and how it operates in the context of contemporary art. I'm going to read this, but you can also follow through your screens. So, the artist's novel is a medium in the visual arts. The artist employs the novel similarly as video or performance, for example. An artist's novel is an artwork dependent on the structure of a novel. Even though it might relate to a literary tradition, it is produced in the context of the visual arts. The artist novel is part of an art project, which may be constituted by different media, amongst which the artist novel usually occupies a preeminent position. The artist novel is a textual work. The use of images and sound takes place in other works of the same art project. The artist novel expands the narrative beyond the space of the page to take place in a body of work that belongs to the same art project. The connection between them is imbued with a shared narrativity, although individually they do not need to be narrative. Because it is a narrative fiction work, the artist novel, and by extension, the art project it belongs to, privileges the use of faculties such as imagination and identification rather than analytical distance. It is predicated on immersion. It favors the deceleration of artistic experience and the protracted engagement of the spectator. The artist's novel appears to the artist, first of all, as a fantasy, the imaginary scenario in which the possible field of contact with their audience could be enlarged thanks to the narrative form and its potential to be widely distributed. The artist's novel is, at least in its most accomplished examples, the result of a collaborative practice. The trajectory that goes from the initial fantasy to the final publication usually traverses paradoxical and contradictory situations. The artist's novel is meant to be read and proposes enjoyment as a valid artistic experience. Paradoxically, the specificity of the artist's novel is not to be found in its text, which at first sight may resemble a conventional novel, but in the process of its creation, which is publicly performed and shown to an audience. It follows that regarding the artist's novel alone would not give a full account of its contents. It is necessary to situate it in the context where it originates, the art project and the artistic processes employed. The artist's novel carries with it a certain inadequacy. Often it is only possible to show fragments that belong to a larger narrative. Hence the difficulty of exhibiting this kind of project, posing curatorial challenges to art institutions. The artist's novel's meaning is not defined by its intrinsic formal qualities only, such as the text printed on the page, but also by the relationship that it establishes with the artistic and institutional context in which it appears and with which it interacts. So this is like, these are fundamental points of definition that David gives us through this book. With having read this, I want to open the discussion with a double question, actually. First of all, addressing David here. David, maybe you can elaborate a little bit on this definition that we just saw together, and also specify in your terms what distinguishes an artist's novel, both from a literary novel and from an artist's book. And secondly, and this question concerns both David and Emre, looking closer at these definition points, I would like us to discuss Emre Hünar's exhibitions and the process of production that led to it, in which a script or a script writing process, which at times became collective, was at work, operating both across the filmmaking process and the production of sculptures and installations, but also the collection of short fiction, which is itself part of the exhibition, Hypernauts by Melih Ayram. Personally, I realized that our process in making this exhibition shares some of these points and diverges from others. Maybe the question would be then, to what extent is this exhibition specifically can be read through the lens of your research?
Okay, thank you, Asli. I realize there are like three questions I have to answer, but I will try to do that one by one. Okay, so let's start with from the beginning. Okay, well, again, thank you for the introduction. So I will try to clarify, first of all, what I refer to when I say artist novel. I don't mean a novel that is written by a visual artist. Okay, let's try to understand this first of all. Visual artists have been writing novels since at least the times of William Morris. So we are talking about the 19th century. I've been making, like you said, a bibliography, and I found more than, at this point, 597 novels written by visual artists. But a legitimate question would be like, why do you pay special attention to these novels? Like, why is a novel written by an artist different from a novel written by a sailor, or a lawyer or a doctor, yeah? And I don't know, I don't have a question, I don't have an answer for that question because that's not my question. When I say the artist novel, I refer to something a little bit more specific, which is those instances in which the novel is employed by the artist as a medium in the visual arts. So for example, imagine that an artist creates an art project where there is performance, installation, and a novel. So I would say that that novel is better understood when it's considered within an artistic discourse, not literary. So if you try to read that novel as a conventional literary novel, normally there are two things that happen. The first one is that you will think that it's a bad novel, that is badly written, because it's not written, sometimes it's not even written by a person, it's produced through artistic processes. So the resulting text, even if it claims to be a novel, is not exactly following the paradigm, the literary paradigm. It's answering problems within an artistic context. The second thing that would happen if you treat an artist novel as a regular novel, like Orhan Pamuk's novel, for example, is that you are going to miss the point of the work. You are going to miss like 90% of the contents of the work. I hope what I'm saying now becomes clearer as we put examples. Normally, the best thing, way to understand this is through examples. But I wanted to clarify that first, that what is the artist novel has been, it's quite a contemporary phenomenon. Let's say that, in my opinion, begins in the 1990s with Liam Gillick. So we are talking about a very contemporary phenomenon. And from these almost 600 novels written by visual artists that I found, let's say that one third of them qualify as artist novels, yes? The others are novels written by a visual artist. But again, you can read them as any other novel and judge them on their literary merits. But that's not what my research is about. Of course, the moment you accept the artist novel as a medium, like performance, video, or installation could be in the visual arts, a lot of questions follow, like, how do you read it? How do you experience it? How do you show it? And I hope, again, that we can start answering these questions through the conversation today, but just a couple of more things. We have to understand that for many artists, the novel is employed as a vehicle to introduce notions that are traditionally ascribed to literature, but they want to introduce them in their artistic practice. And I'm talking, for example, about narrative, fiction, identification, imagination, the bread and butter of a writer, let's say. We are not discovering anything new here for a writer, but for an artist, these are notions that could be implemented in their work. And there are many ways to do this, but the novel is one of them. And what it's also worth considering is that even though the practice of the artist novel has been going on for decades, and if we expand this to novels written by visual artists in general, we are talking about, like I said, since the 19th century. What is really strange is that my book is the first book, to my knowledge, that has been written on the subject of the artist novel. What I want to say is that I started to research this because I am an artist that writes. And then I found I was in the impossibility to speak about my own work. When I was creating a novel as part of an art project, I didn't know how to speak about my own work. And I realized this because there was no critical vocabulary available to me. It was only coming from literary history or literary theory, or literary criticism, but that wasn't explaining what I wanted to do with my novel. And then I realized that there were no books, no articles, no exhibitions, absolutely no critical discourse around the artist novel, except one article published in 2010 in Metropolis M by Maria Fusco. Is the only article I ever found that acknowledges the artist novel as a thing, at least as something that artists may do. But apart from that article, as far as I'm aware, absolute critical obliteration, which is very, very strange. But we can also maybe try to explain that later. And just to finish, what you read is a definition. Yes, I know a lot of people in the art world have problems with definitions because it fixes things and everything has to be fluid and open-ended and indetermined. Okay, don't worry. The purpose of my what I want to say is that my research question is not ontological. I'm not asking what is the artist novel. It is performative. My question is, what does the artist novel do to the visual arts? What is the effect of accepting the novel, not as a literary genre exactly, but more as an artistic medium? What is the impact at all levels? So still I didn't try to avoid the question of the definition. Okay, in my book, I offer a definition like you just read, but I offer it at the beginning of the book. So it's not coming at the end. The outcome of my research is not trying to answer what is the artist novel and then offer a definition at the end. Like I said, for me, the question, the relevant question is rather performative. What does it do? So I offer the definition at the beginning, but again, it's not set in stone. It's not like a rigid 10 rules that if you fail one, you don't qualify as an artist novel. It's more a kind of attempt to clarify the area of research, to clarify the terms in which we can have a discussion. And from there on, more things can happen. So I just wanted to clarify that. I can also answer the other two questions. Ashley, what do you think? Or do you want to?
Yes.
There are still two questions, like what is the difference with a conventional novel and with an artist book? If you want, I can answer that too.
Yes. I mean, I could also, I was just thinking as I was listening to you, I was really interested in how you very often underline the artist's novel as a process and not as a result of something that informs process rather than rather than being an end of its own, an end in its own. Because you know, Emre might say a few words here too, I think, but this is how, and as the curator of this exhibition, I experienced Emre's writing. It's exactly how I experienced it in the process, because of this, because it was a generative text. The text was generating artworks. It wasn't closed and finished thing in and of itself, but it was constantly generating artworks and improvisations and performances. And then all of this, like as these forms were being shaped, they would inform back a rewriting also, or modification of what was written, or new pieces of writing. And I don't know, maybe this further opens it up to new questions, but I thought, because the moment we began working on this exhibitions, we knew that it was going to happen in Artar. And the moment we knew this, Artar itself, the building, the space, and the neighborhood surrounding it started to penetrate in the writing. In a way, this whole process, like because of the process was constantly writing itself and being rewritten, it led to this interesting kind of, a balance of you know, some level of site specificity, because it was in process, but I wonder if the site specificity at points also functions as institutional critique, and in what ways. Like this is something larger, but maybe Emre can also jump in to give us his point of view.
Again, there are like three questions here. I will just start answering, and maybe then Emre can join. The question of process, yes. At least in my opinion, the contents of the artist novel, let's think of the artist novel is an artwork. The contents of the artwork or the contents of the artist novel are usually to be found in the process of its creation, in as much at least, or sometimes even more than in the text that is printed on its pages. I will try to repeat it with other words. The contents of the work in an artist's novel are not to be found so much in the text or in the book that comes usually printed in, but rather the process, the creative process that leads to the creation of that text is already part of the work. So much so that an awareness of this creative process is necessary at the time of reading the. I will give a very simple example. It's very short, and I think it will clarify what I'm saying. So there is this science fiction artist novel. It's called Philippe. It's a project by artist Heman Chong. And then what he did was to invite a number of people, I think something like 10 people who didn't know each other previously. And the challenge was that they would be in a room for a week. And the challenge was to write a science fiction novel in that time, period of time. Of course, 10 people who don't know each other, they have to come up with something that normally, you know, they have to discuss and negotiate things that normally are not up to discussion, no, when writing a novel. So, of course, at the end, you have this science fiction novella and you read it, and there are a lot of mistakes in it. There are incongruences. There are moments, for example, imagine a character is described as being bald, and 3 pages later, he's shown combing his hair. I mean, these kind of things that is an obvious trace of the creative process. Look, if you are reading a novel by Paul Auster and stuff like this happens, you might think, oh, it's badly written. The writer is not keeping track of their own fiction. But here, in this specific case, I think these mistakes are actually traces of the process, and they are part of the specific beauty of this text. So you see what I'm trying to say? What in a conventional novel would be a sign of a mistake, here is a sign of 10 people trying to come up with a coherent narrative in a very short time, negotiating things and while doing their best, yeah? So if you don't have in mind the process of creation, when you read it, you will think it's a bad novel. But it's not a bad novel. It's just, it's a project that involves all these elements of collaboration, et cetera. And you cannot take that writing creative process out of the picture, because then you don't understand what the work is about. That's what I wanted to say about.
Oh, this is beautiful, because I think maybe this is the way, precisely something that you would read as a mistake in a conventional novel becomes something else when it's an artist's novel, because maybe it's the only way or a strategy, maybe it's the best strategy that we have at hand to actually communicate what the process of artistic creation is, rather than giving a novel as a finished form to be consumed and read. But
yeah, I think for most artists who are engaged with this sort of medium, writing, ing, writing is more important than the written. It's not that the final text is inconsequential. No, that's not true. I mean, it's very important also that the novel, the artist novel, is actually read. Yes, but the act of writing as a performative act that actually sustains the artistic practice for a given period of time is many times as important or even more important than the resulting text. And I think this sets apart the artist novel from previous text-based art forms. Like think of, for example, of visual poetry or conceptual art, in which the text is the important element. But here we see that the act of being writing is actually what matters for most of these artists, for several reasons, for various reasons. And many times, yes, it introduces a different temporality in the experience of the work, but also it opens up the creative process and the writing process to an audience, which also creates all kind of strange situations.
This was a major question for Emre and me as we were preparing this exhibition. There was always this idea that, a shared question maybe of, you know, how do you communicate the process of making alongside the work? Yes, there are works of art, there are sculptures, etc. in this exhibition, but what is the best way to communicate something of their, you know, of the process of their making?
Well, I would say the answer is to show the process as it happens, to open it up to the audience. Why not? That's what we did. We tried to do with the Tamam Shoot project. We offered the possibility for an artist to create a new artist novel. What we were asking in the open call, when I say we, I mean Johan and I, the book lovers, we made an open call for the creation of an artist novel. And the only thing we were asking is send us an art project proposal. It has to be an art project. The only condition is that a novel has to emerge throughout the artistic process. How does it emerge? It's up to the artist to propose. But then what we ended up with Alex Sechetti is these 5 episodic performances and 1 exhibition. So some people were following the performances every 2-3 months as if they were episodes of a narrative that was being told it somehow. And then it was written up as a murder mystery novel that came out eventually. So you see, the artistic process and the writing process, they are both shared with an audience. You know, it's not something that happens behind and then you have to reconstruct in retrospective. It's something, that's why I say that the artist novel is not only the book that comes out of it, is the process that leads to the production of this text. If it's by means of performance or an exhibition or interaction with the audience or whatever, that is already the artwork. And the audience are already experiencing that as part of the whole project at large, no?
Yes. I can just jump in here just to say, because now I was thinking how it was for me, this kind of process of knowing what you're writing is part of an exhibition, but you didn't start writing an artist novel per se, you know? So that's, I think that was, that's the part, at least it somehow like separates it from that. But then what I was telling David the other day also, that when you're writing as an artist, at the end, you're doomed to write an artist novel because your writing comes back and then it somehow connects with your other practice or with your works as a medium. Unless, you're really writing like a novel and then that's a literary novel and that's out of this research topic. But what I was thinking, like this process, I think in our collaboration in the exhibition making, I think it was more visible in the script, because I would almost call it an artist's script, because if you look at it, it's not really a script. Like if you look at that as a cinematographer, you would say, hey guys, sorry, but this is really not a script. You just wrote like some scenes or of I don't know what. It's not a shooting script. It's not a storyboard. That was that was an excuse. I think it was an open space, an area for writing, for sculpture making and for filmmaking. And that's why we called it script. And that's why actually, Aslı, you also said scriptology in reference to that, that gave us this open diagram of things that would generate other pieces. Like, yes, with that, we made the film and then during the making of the film, the script evolved because there was the museum and there was the car mechanics we met and there was the engine repair person and his personal life that turned into a documentary. And all of these elements were added to the script. And we actually also didn't know how to share the script because the script was not in a publishable form. It was just on my notebooks with photographs, and we or just paper cuts. And we knew that all the works were somehow related to this script. So that's why actually we decided to include fragments of this script, at least the fragments that actually we didn't really use in the exhibition or in the film, so that it turns into something that who reads the publication of the exhibition after the exhibition can read parts of this script, and as we call it, the open script. But meanwhile, for the fictional writing, which was present also before the exhibition, I was just writing with the idea of writing a novel and not an artist's novel anyway, because I was not, I didn't start with that idea at least. You know, I said, I'm not gonna make an artwork. So this is not an artist's novel. It's not, there was no idea. There was just literature. But then I knew at some point when there's a space for an exhibition, what I wrote will be interacting with those works. So what David says is really correct. You know, it's creation, it's in the process, and that gets somehow involved at the end. And maybe this cannot be seen in the text itself because you can also read it as like any fictional writing.
Yeah, I mean, it begs the question of how do you read these things? And I think you have to go like case by case, is the same way you read, interpret, or decipher any other artwork. So you do the same with the artist novel. Normally, the best way to understand an artwork is to contextualize it. And you start to contextualize it within the practice or the discourse that the artist is trying to develop by means of his artwork, her artworks. So in the case of the artist novel, I would say it's exactly the same. Like, just contextualize the existence of this artist novel within a larger discourse that the artist is trying to develop. So a lot of things that, again, would look weird or strange or just badly written make a lot of sense when you understand the purpose of this sort of writing, or where it comes from, or how it relates to the rest of this artist practice. So in that sense, again, there is no a single answer to the question of how do you show an artist novel, but I think, again, is also the lack of critical discourse around it that, you know, everybody has to answer this question in practice, like you guys are trying to do now. It's like, how do you integrate this text into an artistic experience, into the visitor to the museum? How do we make the text part of the artistic experience? And then again, I think there are many artists who have already provided an answer to that, but I think there is still, you know, a lot to be learned from the institutional side to adapt to this kind of practice, which is gaining more and more adepts every day. There are more and more artist novels written every year. And I think sooner or later, art institutions have to acknowledge the fact that this is something artists do, and they have to start trying to adapt and to show this kind of work that maybe is not exactly, you know, your, for example, in terms of temporality, is totally at odds, no, with the time that you should spend into an art exhibition, no? So, which begs the question again, how do you show this thing, no? Right. Or when is the best moment to read it?
Yeah, you know, also like trying to solve this question, I mean, it's probably one of the first questions, like, how do you show it? Because I think that comes first. Once you solve that, you actually solve almost half of the content of the piece itself. And I remember with Aslı that we were discussing, and also with Arta, with the institution, like, because they were thinking that, yes, this text should be published and it should be in the publication. And we were saying, yes, but it should be both. It should be in the publication as well, but it should be also in the exhibitions in some place. Mm-hmm. I was seeing it as a part of the installation, like in between sculptural work, like a booklet that you could take, and also like a QR code of a PDF that you could download. So then suddenly there was this dilemma of, is this production or is this publications? You know, like institution itself couldn't really decide if the work belongs to the production people or to the publication people. And, you know, like with the budget. And so there's also this kind of practical question, which at the end involves also the audience, because actually you don't want the audience to sit in the space to read half an hour of something when they could look at the space. I mean, it could happen, but that's not the purpose in my case. Mm-hmm. I would like that the audience comes to the exhibition, sees the film, look at the sculptures, discovers that there's a text, and understands that there's a connection, but then reads it somewhere else. You know, that would be the ideal. So at the end, I think that it's part of the like production part. It was part of the sculptural piece, but then it's included in the publication as well, because it's also for free.
This is a question I wanted to ask you, actually, connected to, in a way you already answered it, but I think I could ask you also, because, okay, so in your exhibition curated by Aslı, you have a book with short stories. Okay, it's not an artist novel, but I think a lot of concerns really overlap with my research. That's why we are talking here today. And it's titled Hypernauts. Okay, so it's a collection of short stories, and they share the same origin, the script, let's call it, that also has given way to a body of sculpture and installation and the film. Now, I wanted to ask you, in your case, I think it's very clear the context where the I'm talking about the Hypernauts now, yeah? Uh-huh. It's a collection of short stories. Yeah. I think the context is very well, very clearly defined, because the only place to get a copy of this book is through your exhibition. It's not like you are going to a bookstore and you encounter this book out of context. No, everybody who reads the Hypernauts will have been through your exhibition. So they already have this context. And like you said, your desire is that they read it afterwards. You don't have the idea that they should read it in parallel to viewing the exhibition, but you're aware that these two temporalities are a little bit at odds. Okay, but my question is, at some point the exhibition will end, but then the Hypernauts, the collection of short stories, will remain. So my question is, what degree of autonomy does the text have? Do you think it will offer a meaningful experience when read in isolation in the future without the exhibition? And also, who would be your ideal reader? Somebody who also understands that the book is part of an art project? And what would happen if somebody only reads the book? Again, I'm talking about the future, because the context is very clear.
I mean, obviously I was aware of this since the beginning. That's why I was also saying, like, when I started writing Hypernauts, I didn't think of an exhibition. I was just writing, and then the exhibition came, and I made a selection of my writing, and that writing then got edited and evolved into something that has a connection with the works in the exhibition. So it was already in the beginning autonomous. in a way, but then it became a sort of artist novel or artist writing, and that you could only take it in the exhibition. But after the exhibition, I think, I mean, people who got it during the exhibition or who downloaded and who knew that they can just take it, I think they already saw the exhibition, so they have this idea of space, the sculptural pieces, so they have this connection. But for other people, I don't know how it could be distributed, but if you read the text, let's say, who are not going to exhibitions so often, and just I'm asking their opinion, and just to read it as something that they would read, you know, some stories that I wrote, and it's also with not with my name, but it's there's Meliha Erem on it. So I think the only way that this booklet could go and be read by someone who didn't see the exhibition, that would be by chance, you know, just somebody would give you and say, hey, read this. And then I think the fiction could stand alone. It's just not totally related to the exhibition. You don't lose anything from its content if you don't know the sculptures or the film. It's just they are like instances, well, hyper notes, or like this kind of really fragmentary experimental kind of fiction that has no plot, no characters, but more visual descriptions. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't start or end, but it just shows you fragments of a place in a timeless moment. So you don't know who is who, if it's a female or like male, or you don't know anything, in Turkish at least. But then you just have this kind of fiction that it's close to what I fantasized in like writing in literature, because like if this is a fantasy of the artist, like the fantasy of the novel, then you aim to literature, but then you come back to the artist's novel. Mm-hmm. So I wrote thinking of literature and not to the exhibition. So I think who reads it gets the taste of the literature from it without knowing the sculptures. Like, and I think the format, like the form of it, I can think of other writers that are like more, yeah, I mean, definitely literary writers. Like I was thinking of The Voice Imitator by Thomas Bernhard, for example. These are really short stories. Or like, there are other books that I like Marianne Krollos called Big City. She's not a mainstream writer. I mean, probably she's related to the arts as well somehow. And all this is like experimental, fragmentary writing that you could read. So that was my aim, at least, like outside of the context.
Andre, do you think maybe you could share a fragment of your writing with us? Because my experience is that sometimes when we are talking about writing, sometimes people are like, yeah, but what does it sound like? So would you mind maybe to share an excerpt of your page or something from your Hypernauts?
Yeah.
So we can hear what it sounds like.
Yeah. Well, maybe I can put my headphones, if that's better. So I'm gonna share my screen. So can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I'm gonna share my screen. That's from the PDF, but I'm gonna read it actually from the actual book, because I'm not gonna read it from the screen. But you guys can follow what I'm reading. So this is the last story in Hypernauts. It's called Tar, and it's the longest one, but I'm gonna read just one page from it. So after a week of sleepless anticipation, I too had been able to get an appointment.
The clinic was in a shipping container mounted on a traveling lorry. It reminded me of the traveling libraries and market carts of my childhood. Apparently, I had always preserved this short-lived service as a good memory. I think the prospect of being able to travel in a lorry with its own library held an important place in the daydreams of my childhood. So it was no coincidence that the temporary barracks I built here and there were erected with this fanciful image in mind. Standing before shelves lined with tanks of hexagons that resembled milk cans in all shape and sizes, the doctor welcomed me in. When she realized that my eyes had settled on the thick book on her desk as I explained my discomfort, she quickly glanced through its alphabetical index and, opening to that page, showed me photographs of the most extreme forms that sickness could take, its dangerous stages, its case studies. Purplish swellings hanging like bunches of grapes from the armpits, craters opening on the skin like tiny active volcanoes, sexual organs covered in warts, fingernails brown and withered by ossification, tissues of the hands and feet that transformed into monstrous sponges covered in mucus, highly detailed microscopic images resembling small islands and mounds of sand on the planet's surface. She must have sensed that I grew more nervous with every turn of the page because she asked, "Why are you so interested in this? The sick can't bear to look at these, you know." "Yes," I said, "I can imagine." In that moment, all of these forms, tissues, lesions, bacterial phenomena, parasitic eggs, epidermal cysts, dermatological deformations, all of them give me inspiration as plastic. I look at them as ideas for sculpture, though of course I couldn't confess that. So I closed the subject by saying, "I found the images quite intriguing, that my grandfather was a doctor, and that's why I'm interested in these kind of books." She returned the book, faded, its pages curled from leafing through it to its rightful place, the Atlas of Clinical Dermatology in Color. So I think this this was this is a part that I find quite related to the sculptural work, that like it almost describes its textural quality. Like I think what I was writing is almost the same what I was trying to do with ceramic glazes, like so there's this you know, the deformation of the skin or volcanic geological formations. So I think what I mean, and this one of the stories that I actually wrote before the works, but then I realized actually what I wrote is almost the key for sculptures. But of course, you don't need to know both. You know, you can just read it without seeing the sculptures, because it's not an explanation of anything. Like you can just realize, and that's why I really like what you said. Like they are communicating vessels. Like they almost produce each other, and they're not the definition of one each other, but they just both work parallelly. So somehow.
Can I just say one thing, just related to the short extract that you read? I mean, obviously there's a lot of texture in it in terms of skin rash, irritation, mucus, etc. But there's also at the beginning, there's the spatial descriptions of things like shipping containers, traveling library, lorry, temporary barracks, and also all these cryogenic flagons and milk cans arranged on the shelf in this tiny space. I think it's also very indicative of the installation anoxic event, like this space within a space that stands in the space of Artar. So I think it speaks to both.
Yeah. I think that's what I realized actually. What I was writing, it almost was like a desire of producing sculptures with writing it. It just and I mean like obviously you're writing as an artist so that the same obsessions come back, because I don't write for the sake of the plot. You know, just there are no characters. It's just a like a stream of consciousness kind of writing, the same way that you would make molds of objects and make sculptures by like improvising with clay, and then you make like metal structures. So the architectural references, the cinematic references, they all come back, even though it's not planned, because the writing itself was not really like pre-studied. It was just things that I think the title, the Hypernauts, also comes from that. You know, they were notes that I took really fast while I was traveling, walking, thinking, in the airport, on the train, whatever, and then I thought these are Hypernauts. These are people or characters that they travel in between hyperlinks of text, and there is a kind of deep sea diving, kind of diving into the fiction, and it's all just happens in a kind of a stream of thought, a consciousness kind of writing. So I think that the same obsessions appear. I mean, we made the book like yellow, and that was, I don't know. Then I realized afterwards that there's so much in the stories, almost in each story, or the sky is yellow gray, or the fishes are yellow and something. There's always like the element of yellow and gray somehow. And then if you look at the structure of anoxic event, it's basically yellow and gray. And I think that's totally like, I don't know, like this kind of factory warehouse or science fictional element in architectural film set or whatever. Just, I think even the colors repeat so that it reminds me of these sculptural obsessions in terms of materiality. It's not for the sake of plot, but for the materiality.
I want to insist on something, because I think we've been quick to mention this, but we haven't fully talked about it yet. David, there's this idea of deceleration of the audience's experience, like when in the presence of an artist's novel or in narrativity within the exhibition by means of an artist's novel, one of the effects you mentioned is that it decelerates the audience's experience of the artwork, and I agree with this, but I wonder, you know, on one hand you have this idea of decelerating the artistic experience and of maybe providing a more experience that has more enjoyment, that you know, provide ways for an audience to identify and create empathy, which are, you know, properties of narrativity within how it functions, like one of the things that artist novel does in an exhibition setting. That's on one side. And then on the other side, I realized, I mean, both in my conversations with Emre, but also in your research, from the part of an artist who writes an artist's novel as part of an art project, I sense that there's this desire to go beyond the walls of a museum, as in terms of distribution and reaching an audience that would be a little bit different, maybe. At least there's a desire. I don't know how to what extent this is reached, but I'm wondering whether these two things meet: the deceleration of the artistic experience and the desire to reach beyond the institutional walls or beyond the confines of a regular art-going audience. Mm-hmm.
Yes, they.
These are tendencies, yeah. But I wonder if they are ever reached. You know.
Well, the first thing you refer to is quite an obvious fact, and is that reading a novel takes time. No, it's something that is almost trivial to say. So again, if today we were in a panel with writers and editors and so on, and somebody says, "Oh, reading takes time," it would be like, "Yeah." And We all know that. Now, again, like I said at the beginning, I'm not interested in what the novel does in literature, but what it does in the visual arts. And then for an artist, the possibility that to engage with one of their artworks for days or weeks, which is the time that takes to read a novel, opens up the possibility to a protracted engagement. I mean, for many artists, it's frustrating that you are working on a project for months or even years. And when you show it, we barely spend time in contact with the artwork. I mean, think about how much time you spend in front of a painting or a sculpture or whatever, seconds. And if it's a video or a performance, maybe minutes. But is there a possibility maybe to spend more time? Well, again, the artist novel could be an answer to that problem, or what is perceived by many artists to be a problem, because think of mainstream events like art biennials or large museums. There is too much to see and little time to see. So many artists who are invited to biennials, they know that, and they format their artworks to be quickly dealt with. It's like I call a one-liner. The content of the work is a one-liner. It's one idea, you get it, okay, move on to the next one. There is too much to see. I see this as a form of consumption. It's like consuming art. And I understand that many artists are not satisfied with this experience of their art practice. So they introduce the novel again as a strategy to decelerate the artistic experience. Why? Because the content of the work, it's a story. And a story needs to be, the production of narrative meaning is processual. You can summarize a story. You can read the blurb of a novel in the back side of the book, why not? But that's not the novel, yeah? To engage with a novel, you need to, the text should appeal to the activation of certain subjective faculties, such as identification that works through narrative empathy, imagination, etc. And those things are, unraveling the meaning of the novel gradually. The novel is not given as a one thing. So again, something that in literary terms is something quite trivial in the art world could be perceived as a strategy, you know, to change the way art is actually experienced. I also contextualize this a little bit in the historical moment when we are, like, if you ask people in the art world what is the most important aspect of an artwork, probably many people, the majority of them, they will say is the concept or the idea, like the content of the work is the concept. It's still a consequence of a kind of post-conceptual legacy. I don't say that conceptual art was a determined moment in our history 60 years ago, but the legacy by which one identifies the content of the work with an idea is still very much present. And I find it very problematic. I mean, conceptual art was revolutionary 60 years ago. There's no question about it. But that was 60 years ago. I think we need to move on, to move past the legacy of conceptual art. So in the worst case scenario, many, like I said, it creates artworks that are one-liners. It's like, first of all, the idea comes prescribed by the artist and then legitimated by an art critic or curator or something. It's already sanctioned. Like, this is the meaning of the work. And many times the curatorial text or the art critic's review is just going to inform the spectator what the content of the work is. Why this is what the work means, as if it's a kind of fact that precedes your experience with the artwork. I think in the case of the artist novel is different, because the content of an artist novel is not a concept, it's a story. like I said, it already changes the temporality through which you get in contact with the work. But also, there is no prescribed meaning to what the artist novel actually means. The meaning of the artwork, like I said, the formation of narrative meaning is a process that goes through elaboration that appeals to subjective faculties. And so the text gives me instructions for the production of narrative meaning. And then I have to fill in the gaps in the text through my imagination. But then what do I fill it up with? With my memories, with my expectations, my desires, but they are mine, nobody else's, which means that the interpretation, the experience of every novel or artist novel in this case is very different because, you know, our subjectivity is different from other people, which means that many times the interpretation of the same work will become contradictory depending on who you ask. And I think that is this possibility to slow down the production and the experience of art, to not to have like one meaning that you have to just discover and then basically consume, but actually to produce, and maybe it produces contradictory meanings, the same work, that is not very well, that doesn't fit very well with the way art is presented to the public today. Like all these institutional inertias are based on a certain understanding of how we experience art from time and space to actually what the meaning of the work, where you have to look for the meaning of the work and how it's sanctioned through a text that is written by a third person, not the artist. So again, I think the artist novel might appear as a possibility to offer something different, to offer a text that contextualizes the work from a different perspective, not from a critical perspective, but a fictional perspective, if that makes sense.
Well, it does. I mean, of fictional perspective, but also in terms of world building, maybe is also a relevant term. Especially with this exhibition, I think there's the, I don't know, Emre, how do you feel about this idea of world building? Is this something you think you do?
Yeah. I mean, definitely. I think I was going to come to that and ask later a question to David. I think, you know, the important thing, maybe the idea of deceleration of the perception also and the production of the artwork. And I think writing maybe for the artist helps because it's always an alternative way of making things without really dealing with the space, let's say, in the production, the idea of the production and budget and so on, but it's very intimate and very isolated space, but it's also really a productive and fertile one. And it's also an area that probably you don't have the right tools, you're not trained, so you just fantasize it and then it just opens up for you like the new possibilities, because you approach to the medium, to the artist novel or to the artist writing as something new, and that really goes together with this idea of world building. For me, for example, that I always see this relationship between like the speculative fiction, experimental writing, and the artwork. I think in my practice has always been like that, even though I never shared. Like, if you remember, we were talking about how to share the process behind the work, how to make the process visible in the work, that it becomes the work itself. I think this part of writing that was always present in my work, because I've been keeping like all these, I still do that as like an ongoing project, which I never completed, but this idea of like writing science fictional artist novel from Wikipedia pages, that totally like modifying Wikipedia. And I mean, it stands somewhere in between uncreative writing and an artist novel. And I think that there you can totally see the idea of world building, and world building then gives you the possibility of jumping to the three-dimensional exhibitional space, making of objects, but not necessarily, because I think that's also then it's a loop. You know, I was also afraid that what you write, then it gets devoured by your other desires of making sculptures and making exhibitions. Then you end up writing only for the purpose of making other things. And I don't want that. I actually almost would exclude the exhibitional institutional space and focus maybe on the space of the artist novel and form of writing. And I think I was also thinking today while reading like other things, like as I was telling you guys, like when Tom McCarthy says like here in the conversation with Ingo, the end of the book has always been the possibility of the book. And I really like that the possibility. So I mean, maybe even writers, like literary writers writing experimental novels, can actually look at the artist novels for, because somehow there's something happening there as also a more open and free area inside the literature itself. You know, like you don't want to, I mean, you can read, but it's not the mainstream literature if you want to read the artist novel within the context or not. You know, it's never going to be, I mean, in rare cases maybe, but so I think, yeah, the world building is, it's a great part, and it's for free. You can just write and imagine things that you would probably make. And so that's why it's not for the plot, but it's for the materiality. That's what I was thinking, like for sharing those references secretly for the audience who wants to spend more time in an intimate situation outside of the like see and go kind of biennial or whatever kind of exhibition. And maybe I can ask David something like, were you going to say something? Or?
Yeah, but maybe I don't know if I should say it or not now. I mean, I just all of this, and you know, because in David's book there's a lot of examples, case studies, and the case studies that he gathered in this book, there's a lot of artists who use performance, you know, moments of performance, yeah, to meet the audience, to make the novel meet the audience. And I just thought of this now, but there was a point in time when we were, before we installed the exhibition, especially when we were shooting with actors, I remember us talking about the possible performance too.
Yeah.
You know, that we imagined, and we wanted a pop performance to take place inside the exhibition, that we would invite the actors back maybe, and then maybe the
performers
would act or something. I mean, there were all these ideas that eventually got completely sidelined because of COVID and, yeah, and the impossibility of physical presence. But maybe performance is also an interesting thing to think about for the future in terms, mm-hmm, of, you know, how you share the process and how you share an artist's novel.
Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking since this writing got involved with the exhibition, actually, I'm thinking artist novelizing the film, like going back from the film and writing the film as a novel, because then now you can describe what you see and you can edit it as a novel. You don't need to watch and then
Amre, if I can interrupt, sorry.
Yeah,
I recommend you to take a look at Fiona Banner's work.
Okay.
She has this what I consider an artist novel. It's called The Nam.
Mm-hmm.
It's a huge book, and what she did was to I think she watched like four of the most famous Hollywood movies which are about the Vietnam War. And what she did was to sit down and watch the movies one after another and write down what she saw. So basically she's describing a movie, but because the movie has a narrative structure, then it turns out that this description is also a narrative. and then they are connected one after another. So at the end, it's like a massive novel about the Vietnam War. So I was thinking about what you were talking about actually transforming the film into a novel. Well, she did it in this very direct way, yeah. And it's very impressive, actually.
Yeah, I mean, I will definitely. I mean, it's also like a decoupage. You know, you would just write the shooting script by watching sequence by sequence. Mm. But then, of course, if you write as an artist novel, as she did, I didn't read it, but I'm going to look at it. Then it becomes a different thing. Then it becomes a medium, or its materiality should be interesting. So then, but I wanted to ask you this, and maybe I read a small part from your book, and then I can ask you something. Your research as novel, the fantasy of novel. So this is a part from that. At first, art project and artist novel were two communicating vessels within the same system. On the one hand, the artwork's meaning was altered by the inclusion in an overarching narrative. On the other, the artist novel was the recipient of that same narrative, which was written through the artwork's reinterpretation. The same text could be used as a performance script and appear as a passage in the artist novel. Alex had transformed the exhibition into a writing device. Thanks to the detective's note that fed his writing, the exhibition preceded and produced the narrative text. The communicating vessels had been replaced with a machine that made the text. So I find this very, important moment also in the novel that the David character explains. So I wanted to ask you, like, how was it for you, like being at the same time the co-curator of a project for an artist novel and writing a research as an artist novel as you work, using the documentation and your own experience of that project, and you also talk about careful administration of fiction in that project. I was really curious to hear about that.
Yeah, maybe I should clarify first that I was doing a PhD, like Ashley explained at the beginning. I was doing a PhD on the artist novel, and it was a practice-led research project, which meant that 50% of my research I wrote as a regular, say, conventional academic essay. I did this in Edinburgh, in the UK. And the other 50% would be practice. So it was exactly at the time when I had to decide what this practice would be that I was with the Book Lovers co-commissioning the creation of a new artist novel, this Tamam Shud by Alex Sacchetti. So we launched the open call, and, well, long story short, Alex's project was selected from 230 applications. So we had 2 years to produce his art project, like I said before, 5 episodic performances and 1 exhibition. And then I decided to use this project that he was going to make and we were going to produce as a key case study, something to research. Because, like I said before, in my opinion, the process of creation is where the contents of the artist novel actually happen for the most part. So this was like a unique opportunity to research that as it happened in real time. I wasn't the artist, I wasn't at the center of the project, Alex was, but I wasn't also completely a stranger, an outsider observer. I was part of the project, but I was in the middle of it as the co-curator. So that gave me the right distance, I think, to observe the whole trajectory that goes from what I call the fantasy of the novel, the desires that the artist wants to fulfill by choosing a novel as an artistic medium, to the reality of this artist novel in the world 2 years later when it's actually published and read by an audience. So what I did was to accompany the process. And I could have given an account of this creative process in many ways, say, for example, documentary, yeah, with archival material, video footage, stuff like that. But I also felt that the aspects of the creative process I was interested in, I couldn't really show them if I was showing only archival material. So that's when I decided to narrate this process, to make justice to the idea of process and transformation. A narrative seemed to be like an ideal way to write. In principle, it doesn't sound very academic. So the challenge was, how do I fictionalize an art project into something that reads like a novel? So it's not a novel exactly, it's research written as a novel, or say I was using novelistic devices at the service of my research. So by doing that, for example, I could give an account of private conversations. The curator and the artist and the director of the art center having dinner and discussing stuff that will later have an impact when at the time of deciding on the budget of the project. And the budget obviously dictates what is possible and what is not in terms of production. So all these elements in the creative process, all these what I call the informal factors of artistic production, these are usually invisible to art audiences. But artists like us, curators, we are all very familiar with it. The thing is that they are rarely committed to writing. So I decided to write about this. And again, fictionalizing real conversations as dialogues, real people as characters, et cetera, seemed to me the best way to convey all these aspects that I wanted to investigate. And just to answer about the careful administration of fiction, I want to say that, yeah, if I was writing a novel, I could use fiction freely. I could have said, yeah, the artist's novel was beamed down by a UFO that visited the planet Earth, and maybe as a story is good, I don't know. But I couldn't do that, because that using too much fiction would undermine the research value. If the reader has the impression that I'm fabricating the events, that I'm making up things, then there is no research value in it. No knowledge has been produced. At the same time, I couldn't just give a kind of report of how things happened. Like, okay, day one, this happened, day two, this happened, day three, this happened, because then it would be, yeah, a report or a diary. But I wanted to tell a story. And life, real life, doesn't have a plot, doesn't have ideas that articulate a narrative. And I wanted to articulate my text with ideas that are told through narrative. So I had to use fiction, but very carefully. Again, not too much would undermine the research value, too little would make the text unreadable. And I wanted the reader to engage the reader again with their subjective faculties, to want to read more, to turn the next page, to put questions in the head of the reader, and to invest their emotions, to immerse themselves in the text. I ended up, and I finished my long answer with this, I ended up making like two narrative vectors. One was a faithful account of the artistic process that Alex was intertwining performance, installation, and the writing of the novel. And I give a very faithful account of how these two processes go in parallel. And then the second narrative vector was a kind of dramatic plot that I had to come up with, you know, like between the protagonists, like there is a kind of strange love triangle, Oedipal triangle. Was it real? No. Was it based on the exaggeration of actual dynamics that I observe between the participants in the project? Yes. Was it a structure that was given from the beginning? No, it helped me to write more creatively around the events. But at the same time, the relationship between writing and the actual events as they were happening, because I was writing in parallel to them, was dynamic. Sometimes I had to revisit this kind of dramatic plot in light of what was actually happening in reality. So at the end, I hope that the reader sees very clearly what is at the service of a dramatic effect and what is really at the service of research. Both things are connected, but I think at the same time, when you reach the end of the novel, you kind of have a pretty clear idea of what is what. And sorry for the long answer, but yeah, I got to explain everything.
No, yeah, thanks for that. I think that what I was exactly asking, because I was also thinking about that. It's, I mean, isn't anyway the way that literature is also made? Because I was thinking like Enrique Villamatas or Javier Marias or Ricardo Pilla, like if you think of like autobiographical or like autofictional elements in real life events merged into literature and not written as a research, but there's always like an archival, academic, or even related to the art world material in it.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, there is something that I took from Villamatas, and it is what.
Yes, you did. Sorry. Research. No, I couldn't hear you.
You mentioned Villamatas, and there is something I took from him, which is what he calls the reality effect. For example, I didn't change the name of the participants in the project. In my novel, if you Google everybody's names, they are actual people. If you Google that sudden performance happened at this time in this date, and you can find that it's there, it happened. Now, I only I asked permission to everyone to be included in this project. So there are a couple of people I have to change their name, but I wanted to create this reality effect, yeah, that you are reading about real people and about real events. But yeah, like I said, I didn't write a novel exactly. Again, I was using novelistic elements at the service of my research. I think that's the big difference. Again, I didn't come up with a plot and tell a story. Like I said, I couldn't just make up the facts. I was researching an art project, and I thought the best way to write about it was to write in this particular way. But at the end of the day, is a PhD thesis. And I had to adapt it a little bit when I published it as a book. So especially the theoretical element of it, so it doesn't reach so academic. But yeah, that is definitely the purpose of this novel.
But anyway, it can be also read as a, like a normal book, I think.
Yes. I mean, you can read everything as you like. You can read IKEA instruction manual as you read Don Quixote. I mean, but my recommendation is that you read this as what it is. It's a work of research. Because again, if you open my novel with the expectation to read Paul Auster or Ali Smith or Rampamuk, it's not going to meet those expectations.
No, because of course.
It's not serving the same purpose. Now, if you read the introduction I put at the beginning, is to frame the right kind of reading experience, the right kind of expectation, I would say. So expect to learn something from reading this. This is what the research is doing, producing knowledge. Maybe the story is not that good, but the service is at the service of that.
Of course. I mean, I totally understand. And I think the readers of your book will understand as well. I just think that like fiction itself also produces knowledge. That's why I was saying.
Yes, of course. Yeah, definitely. I mean, what I expect people learn when reading my novel, The Fantasy of the Novel, is not only that certain things happen at a certain moment in time, or how they happened, but also, and this is thanks to writing fiction, what it feels like to create an artist novel. Like to occupy the position, the point of view of the narrator, you will understand how many things are subjected to misunderstandings, jealousy, bad blood, or the opposite, or too much love between, you know, the people who are taking part of it. And you understand that much better through identifying with a certain point of view, and that is using your imagination, and again by means of fiction. This is what you can learn. Definitely you can learn about experiences that you never lived. like in a vicarious way. You can, but it is, this is true for any work of fiction. Like you can learn about, or you can think that you learn what it is like to, I don't know, be lose a child to death, or to be in the Second World War, or whatever story you're reading.
Mm.
So that's definitely a sort of knowledge that is very specific to fiction literature. Yeah, absolutely.
I want to ask Maltam if we have any audience questions at this point. And if we don't, if we do, let's get them. And if we don't, I want to ask the audience a question. Is that possible?
Yes, it's possible. And let me ask to the audience, if you would like to ask your question, you can use the raise hand button.
Or chat.
Or chat, yes.
Well, let me ask my question, because, you know, we've been discussing this both with David and Emre in the days that preceded today. This is only speculative because I'm not an audience member, and I am curious to know how their experience was of seeing this exhibition and having this collection of short stories, and how they read it. Like, did they read it on site? Did the reading happen afterwards? Did the reading of these short stories make them go back? You know, what it is that they experienced, which is an experience, you know, I personally will never have. But if anyone wants to share, please do.
I think that's going to be difficult.
I could not ask it.
Yeah, I mean, I think you can get that information just by coincidence, and probably by just, you know, I mean, I don't know. Yeah. I mean, actually, we also talked a lot. It's like,
okay, then let me ask a question to David. Also, in the previous days, we discussed, I mean, this is a question I keep asking myself and I wish would happen, but, you know, in most cases with artists' novels, what you have is they're attached to the context of an exhibition or a performance, as you define. And once the duration of the performance or the exhibition or the relationship with the institution hosting these things is over, in general, they're not reprinted. I rarely encounter a reprint of an artist's novel that was printed in connection with some exhibition 10 years ago or 5 years ago. They are usually out of print, and it's hard to access them, actually. Do you see that? And do you see any evolution towards maybe this becoming a thing that this content might be, I don't know, produced in a different, and distributed in a different way, made more accessible? Do you see any movement of institutions towards embracing this form?
Not really. I mean, again, it depends on the will, the willingness of the curator and the institution that are creating that project in particular that has an artist novel at its heart. But again, because there is such a lack of knowledge about this kind of practice, normally are solutions that are very ad hoc, very specific to the project that is being dealt with. Again, because there is no knowledge available there, like to the question how to show an artist novel, again, nobody even put the question before there. So it has to be always answered as they go. And so as for the artist novels themselves to be hard to find, well, yeah, I mean, some of them are published by the gallery or the institution that holds the so sometimes they are in a very short run. I don't know, it depends. Sometimes, I don't know, like for example, Golding and Senevi's Headless, it was a 7-year long project. So people were very aware that this 7-year long project was at the service of producing a kind of murder mystery story. So when it was published, I think it was kind of anticipated. But yeah, I mean, yeah, for sure, they are not bestsellers. I mean, and then it's not something you are going to find in a bookstore or something, unless it's specialized in contemporary art. So yeah, I can imagine that some are kind of hard to find. Yeah.
Well, Hypernauts has been, I think, it's part of the book that be that's available at Artar, like since today. So the publication that accompanies this exhibition is also, if you buy it, you also buy Hypernauts. Actually, it's together with it as an insert. So that might provide us some little bit of distribution further into time once the exhibition is over, should people be interested in purchasing it. But yeah, I think, I don't know. Emre, do you ever intend to maybe, because I know that you're writing more Hypernauts, that it's not done.
Yeah.
Do you think you would ever have the intention of collecting them together at some point and reprinting them?
Sorry, I just couldn't hear the whole question.
It was just to see how you see the kind of the life of Hypernauts beyond the exhibition, because I know that you've been writing more of them, like there are more short stories gather under this title. Do you see them, do you see it collecting them all together at some point in the future, for example?
Well, I mean, yeah, that's totally enters in the area of this fantasy again, but I totally do. I mean, because now for the exhibition that we have at St. Joseph High School, I wrote more of them. Actually, one is totally related to that exhibition. And actually, I mean, we don't have the English translation yet. Would have been good, because that also goes into the area a little bit of ficto criticism, that it's related to the curatorial practice. I was imagining this, taken from your text for my exhibition. I took the curatomaton as the automaton curator, and fictionalized that. But there are kind of 10, 15 more texts that were not finished totally, or they didn't need to be included in this selection. But the thing is, I don't know yet how they can all come together. Maybe, I think that's the question that I would answer in my mind, if these will be put together as a book and then sent to a publisher, and not as an artist book but as Meliha Erem, or they will always be related to the area of the art context, and then it could be published again with a museum show, but I don't know, maybe 20 of them together, but then that should have another title and that should state that these were pre-published, some of them, etc. So I think I would prefer to put them all together and publish with another name as its own on it, with Meliha Erem, and just give it another life in the world of literature, if that would ever be possible. But not, I mean, I'm not saying this actually for reaching more amount of readers, because I know that would be always directed to a niche of readers that read very short stories as experimental fiction. I just want them to be free of their artistic luggage and to be also read as literature at some point, if that's possible, and that we will see. I don't know.
Aslı, we have a question from the chat window. Silvia Kovali asks, thank you for the wonderful talk. As I have not seen yet the show, I wanted to ask Emre how autonomous the physical work is from the written work, and how they move on after the exhibition ends. Thank you.
Thanks, Silvia. That's an important question, obviously, because it's also like the reverse of the thing. I think like the physical works have almost no connection to the text itself. I mean, I think that's why I was saying like the text is part of a sculptural piece that is just there with them. And it's a communicating vessel, as David defines. And but the sculptural pieces are completely autonomous, and they don't need hypernauts to be seen. But regarding the completeness of the pieces in the exhibition, I think that's going to be a difficult question to answer, because there are like a couple of series of works that standing alone sculptural pieces, but they are part of a series. Meanwhile, the other ones are more installative pieces, and at the moment, everything in the exhibition is obviously site-specifically installed. There are two pieces that are totally site-specific, because they are intervention in the space. Like there's a concrete window and then a sectional door that was not part of the original museum space that I added. But once the exhibition is deinstalled, it will totally depend from where they will be reinstalled again, you know? So I think they could change shape in maybe not all the pieces, because let's say anoxic event, this metal structure, and that's something fixed. And also untitled aggressive mimetic, the wave breaker like sculpture, that's something fixed. The sculptures one by one, they would stay as they are. But then obviously I don't know how would I reinstall them if I go to a smaller space. But we can see the example of this, for example, in the St. Joseph High School, because now in Arter the ceiling is more than 8 meters. So obviously there's this huge spread of structure. The ideal would be to keep the work as it's installed. But to demand that it should be installed again in the same way, that's, I don't know. And coming back to the relationship with its fictional extension, I think hypernauts could be republished in another occasion and to be shown and distributed together with anoxic event, for example. But what happens if there are more hypernauts by then? That's what I was asking, actually, also. I think that I should reconsider maybe, just to keep them for this occasion, and then to publish another thing that includes other stories. I think that's not a really fixed position. I hope I answered.
Do you have any more questions? No?
No.
Well, if not, maybe we could slowly start wrapping up, I think. Just as a reminder, maybe it would be good to tell you that David's book stack, the two-volume book we've been discussing throughout this conversation, is available to consult in Artar's library, for those of you who would be interested in knowing more. There is a dedicated section to Emre Ünar's exhibition. You should find it there. Unless Emre still has it, because he borrowed it.
I have it, yeah.
Okay. So it will return soon to the library.
I will bring the library copy back, yeah.
And then, it's available to consult there. And the exhibition runs until January 2nd. So you have 5 more weeks to revisit in case you want to also see the book, the newly published book. So that's that, I guess. David, thank you for taking the time to discuss with us today.
Thank you for the invitation.
And I hope to be informed. We will all want to follow more of what's to come in this research. So we're following. And Emre, I guess, talk to you soon.
Yeah, thank you so much, Asta, for putting us together with David, and also David for sharing your experience and research with me and your comments.
Thanks for the opportunity, for the invitation. It was very nice.
Yes.
Well, in that case, I'm going to say goodbye and thank you all for joining us tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
That's out.